Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This evening's topic lecture is organized by the Institute for Mathematical Sciences at NUS as part of the Institute's outreach program. We are privileged to have world-renowned mathematician Professor Edna Friedman as the speaker. I will say a few words about him. I told him that I will take up 5 minutes of his time. Probably shorter, let's be faster. Well, Professor Friedman has made important contributions both in theory and applications to partial differential equations, stochastic differential equations, and control theory. His career, especially during the past 2 decades, epitomizes a personal mission and relentless drive in bringing the tools of modern analysis to bear in the service of industry and science. His distinguished career began at the Hebrew University, Israel, and weaved in a somewhat colorful way through Kansas, Indiana, Berkeley, Minnesota, Stanford, Northwestern, and Purdue, culminating in the directorship of the Institute for Mathematics and its applications in Minnesota from 1987 to 1997, and of the Mathematical Biosciences Institute of the Ohio State University since 2001. He is also a distinguished university professor at the Ohio State University. This is his latest in a chain of numerous distinguished professorships in the universities he has passed through. He has served on many U.S. national boards and advisory committees. He has also served and continues to serve on the editorial boards of numerous leading journals in analysis, applied mathematics, and mathematical physics. His prolific research and scholarly output has resulted in more than 400 publications, written singly and jointly, and 220 books. Among the honors and awards he has received for his wide-ranging contributions are the Stampatia Prize, NSF Special Creativity Award, a membership of American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and of the U.S. National Academy of Sciences. He has been, and fortunately for us, he has been a founding member of the Scientific Advisory Board of the NUS Institute for Mathematical Sciences, and has contributed significantly and tremendously to the development and success of the Institute since its inception in 2000. It is now my great pleasure to invite Professor Friedman to deliver his public lecture entitled, What is Mathematical Biology and How Useful Is It? Ebner.
By the way, this is my office here. I have 4 windows. That's how one measures one's importance in this newly made building, which is historic, but everything inside is sort of modern. So this is the topic that I'm going to talk about. The first one, what is life, is just for fun. And I'll explain what is, I consider to be math biology, and then give you examples. Really, by examples, one can have a good feeling about anything. So, what's the definition of life? Or actually, what's the unit of life? Oops. Okay, so what we see here is a cell. The cell has a nucleus. It doesn't really have a nucleus. Bacteria does not have a nucleus. Red blood cells don't have nucleus. But most cells do. And what characterizes this particular body, which is is very small, like 10 microns diameter. Four things, that's according to a book which I don't recommend that you buy. It's not very interesting, except for the first three pages from which I took this thing. So the first thing is about a living cell. Is there is flux of matter and energy in it. It absorbs various nutrients. It digests them, produces biomass, and gets rid of waste products. The flux of matter and energy. Adaptation. So it evolves according to, or moves according to conditions. It may crawl, it may get signals, it can produce, secretes some chemokines or things like that. If necessary, it may commit suicide for the goodness of the other cells. This is also adaptation. Next thing is organization. So if you take a bacteria, small bacteria, 300 billion molecules, they are not just randomly distributed. They are all, there are lots of organizations there. As you know, for example, in the nucleus there is the DNA, it makes proteins, it makes RNA, it makes proteins, it makes proteins according to demands that the cell needs, it needs certain things. Message gets to the DNA, produce this thing, transcribe it, and be translated. So all of this is highly organized, 300 million players play together in this tiny little thing. And if you want to know how complicated biology is, in the human body, there are 100,000 of billions of cells. I could say 10 to the 14, but it's more impressive to use 100,000 of billions of cells. And each cell is not independent of the others. They are all connecting to each other. So in addition to all this organization that takes place here, there is also all these messages that are getting, like when I push this button here, a message goes from my head as I look at this and I feel that I went through organization and I go to the next one, a message gets to push this button with my thumb. And all kinds of neurons are involved. All kinds of messages are given from one cell to another. That's a high degree of organization, and that makes what makes biology very complicated. If you look at in physics, then say in a material, then if you see one molecule, you have seen them all. They're all the same, they all behave the same. In water, one drop is the same as any other drop, but in a living cell, a living organism, one molecule can make a big difference. One molecule in one cell can make a big difference, can cause all kinds of things. The last thing is self-reproduction. Not by external forces, by in autonomous way. So if you look at number 1, 2, 3, so you have, Professor Chen mentioned the industry. He's now falling asleep, but I can't blame him. He worked very hard today. So I was just mentioning that industry, that I was involved in industry. So every company has all these characteristics, flux of matter and energy. If you think of General Motors, for example, or Siemens, they adapt to what various needs, high human relations, human resources, and so on. All kinds of, they adapt new machinery. The organization certainly is very much involved. Maybe not 100, 300 million, but maybe 30 people or 300. The thing that they don't have is self-reproduction. There's no company in the world that self-reproduces itself. So this is really the most important thing in the characterization of life. Okay, let me go now to the actual content of my talk. So what is mathematical biology? Number one, you have to have the biologist there. You have to talk to biologists, see what kind of problem they are working on, what kind of biological process they are making experiments with, what kind of data they obtain. Number two, as a mathematician, you are going to try to moderate this process. And having developed a model, you want to simulate it and to see if numerically whatever you get fits with the biological experiment. If suppose the model is differential equations, you have to adjust the terms and adjust the coefficients, and then try to simulate, see if you get the result of the experiment. In choosing the variables involved in the process, this is very tricky because you can't take all these 300 million molecules, or you have to restrict the number of players. Also, on one hand, the model will look realistic. On the other hand, it will be manageable mathematically and computationally. So the modeling is really very critical importance. And then you have to test and see if it fits the experiment. If it did, then it's not the end of the story, because the biologist will tell you, well, what you are telling me with your mathematics, I already know. Tell me something I don't know. So you have to take this model and try to say, well, if I'm going to cut a certain relationship, a certain connection, what will I get? If I put some drug to block a certain protein from being manufactured, will this help or not? Then you make hypotheses. And then you try to persuade the biologist to do the experiments and see if your prediction is correct. And if you walk with the biologist all the way, he will be happy to make these experiments, and that will be a success story. So if the mathematical model helps to promote an hypothesis, even if the experiment does not succeed, at least you know you are, this is not the way to go somewhere else. So this is what the mathematical biology is about. Now, is there new mathematics coming out of it? Maybe not immediately, maybe not at all for a while, but history always shows that all of them you try to, new mathematics is always developing when mathematics interact with the real life situations. So in the long term, and this will introduce also new mathematics, but the goal is to help with mathematics to develop biology. So I'm going to give you examples. The examples are many examples, so I just pick up those from which I myself was involved in this research. I'll give you four examples. So but here's a cycle that I just mentioned there. You go from experimenting data to modeling to, parameter estimation. You happen to say differential equations system that is supposed to represent a biological thing. The question is, what are the coefficients? Sometimes it is known to the literature, but other times, in fact, many times, it is not known. You have to make a guess, and you better make a good guess. Otherwise, you will get results that don't fit. So, trying to estimate parameters is maybe a long story. And then the simulation, the experiment, and goes back and forth, not back and forth, but goes around, and until you are satisfied that the model prediction fit experiments, and then you can use it as a tool to further make visual hypotheses. So this is an example from wound healing. So now chronic wound healing is a big problem. A patient that lies in the hospital for a while is likely to develop skin wounds on the side that he or she lies, and that can actually become very dangerous, not to speak of the fact that they are also very expensive. So in terms of money, it is 5 to 10 it's billion, not million, 5 to 10 billion US dollars, less than euros. So, but anyway, it's a big problem. And in fact, we have been working with the director of the center of Woodhill at the end of Ohio State on this project. That's the last year Shandon Sen. And Woodhill is a complex phenomenon, complex process. And one has to capture, we like to capture the main players there in a small number of variables. And in this work, we try to concentrate on what is the effect of oxygen on the healing process. So if you deliver some drugs, like growth factors, and not enough oxygen, it wouldn't work. It's like putting wood to a fire without the fire, without a match, or without oxygen. Oxygen is critical. Too little oxygen is also bad. Too much is also bad. You know, it has to be somehow. So what we wanted to examine the role of oxygen, and what there are intervention procedures where you put the wound or the person with the wound in a hyperbaric chamber in which a certain concentration of oxygen is brought in, appropriate one, trying to improve the healing. How do we measure improvement in healing? So let me go to the next scheme here and explain how we do that. So here is a wound. What happens is, once there is a wound, a cut, or ischemia, or a stroke, whatever the wound is, macrophages, certain kind of cells that are a part of the immune system, are moving in. They are the first to move in, and as they move in, they secrete some growth factors which attract fibroblasts into the wound. Fibroblasts make the material upon which things, cells can move. Think of fibroblasts as making railroads so that cargo can come in. What is very important to come in is the blood. Because without blood supply into the wound will not heal. So then having blood supplies, blood vessels grow and move into the wound, this is called angiogenesis. And we would like to, and it's very difficult to model vessels growing and moving and so on in dynamic way. So we identify the blood vessel by the cells that enclose the blood vessel. So blood vessels are enclosed by cells. It's a closed system, otherwise, you know, your body will just be bleeding all the time internally. So they are enclosed by cells, which are called endothelial cells. So we think of endothelial cells moving into the wound as a process of angiogenesis. Now this growth factor that I mentioned are also inviting the blood angiogenesis to come in. So what we have here in the wound, we have the macrophages, the fibroblasts that make the railroad, the growth factors secreted by the macrophage, the endothelial cells. Now the way the blood moves, here is a vessel that's supposed to be here on at the edge. This vessel begins to produce capillary tips. And when these tips close, we get what's called anastomosis, and you have here a new blood vessel. So these are the things that are going to go to spouts, are going to move into the wound. So here are the variables that we are using. They are not all the variables, there are many more, but these are the, we think of to be the main ones. So we have the macrophages, we have the oxygen supply, which I have not talked about it yet. We have the fibroblasts, we have the material, the railroad, which I call extracellular matrix, which is, we have the capillary tips and we have the capillary sprouts. Let's see, macrophages are cells, fibroblasts are cells, capillary tips and capillary sprouts, these are all cells. Chemoid tractant is chemical. And oxygen is also a chemical, simple chemical. Okay? Altogether, so we get a system of seven variables, seven partial differential equations. We have to use partial differential because we have a geometry. We have a geometry here. We have a wound and things are moving. We have space variable, we have time variable, we have space variable, and write down all the diagram that I mentioned earlier here, you try to express it in terms of partial differential equations, then we get 45 parameters. We said that even with a smaller number, you can do whatever, like pass an elephant or time to get or something. Anyway, we were able to identify 30 of these parameters from the literature. The remaining we have to estimate. And we have to estimate it so that what we get is fit with experiments. This is just to show you what it looks like. Since it's a public lecture, I can go to the next one. This is a public lecture, I can skip this one too. Here are all the coefficients, and whenever it says PW means this work. But this is estimated both from the talking to experimentalists or the intuition about it, and from trying to consider somewhat parallel situation in which we know something. Now this is the most important thing. What we see here is this, the black, okay, on the left side is the average number of endothelial cells. This is the angiogenesis, which we take to be the measure of health. The more we have of this, the higher it is, the better the healing process is over time. The time is 10 days in the life of a mouse which has a tetanus wound that is being healed. So it's a, we are comparing the experiment done on tetanus wound of a mouse. So this is the curve when the oxygen, so we are providing oxygen, we are putting the mouse in a hyperbaric chamber. I thought it was a thunder and raining or something. Okay, that's better. Okay, so we are putting the mouse in hyperbaric chamber, supposedly in the model, and we are trying to see how it affects the healing. If we are providing with the energy, with the oxygen, which is normoxic, which is the natural oxygen pressure in a tissue, this is a black curve. But in a wound, usually there is less oxygen because the vascular system of the blood has not yet moved into the wound. It takes time for it to move. So usually there is less, and it's a hypoxic situation. If this persists, this is the lowest level, about 50% of the normoxic situation, the average, then you see that the healing is not as good, that the angiogenesis concentration is low over time. The 75% is the red one, and this is the normoxic. But if we give more oxygen, we get something better. If we increase, this was unit one, normoxic. If we increase to unit two, we get this higher level. To unit three, we get something you cannot see, but it lies above it. Unit four drops. Overly hyperoxic oxygen is toxic stuff. If it's toxic, it does not allow the healing process to go well. And this is a very good fit what we see with experimental results. Now, what they often do is they put the mouse in hyperbaric chamber and increase the oxygen amount 90 minutes a day. What we see in this graph is the difference between not giving the 90 minutes a day and giving it 90 minutes a day. And we are starting with a level which is level 2 here, and then with the 90 minutes a day at level 3, we see an improvement. This is the difference. not the absolute value, but the difference. And we give a level 4, and again, you cannot see the picture here. It becomes still a little better. So now, so this model, then we think of it at this time to be satisfactory. Of course, we may be wrong, and maybe the coefficients are in the wrong regime, but they are still doing a good job for this experiment. But that's always like this in science. You are never sure until you make a new experiment, and then you have to change things. But it now suggests that we can try to do twice a day 90 minutes, or give, increase it for 90 minutes, and then lower it for 90 minutes. If you lower it, when there is hypoxia, the macrophages, which come at the very beginning, secrete more growth factors, and maybe it may be better. So we can try to do all these things. So this paper will appear in the PNAS, and the supplementary material will give various possibilities, various other procedures by which one can try, and we see a little improvement here or there. So it may be used now as a tool to suggest different hyperbaric chamber protocols. So that's the first example. Second one is, I hope you don't go home having nightmares, because I'm not talking about all kinds of diseases. This is in case your kidney has a problem. If the kidney loses 90% of its functionality, then there are two choices. Either to have a new kidney, it's a kidney transplant. And if you are 70 years old, you have no choice, because the waiting list is probably 5 years. They don't do it if you're 75. Or to have dialysis, which is a big nuisance. What they have to do is, in dialysis, they puncture at the vein, at the artery. The artery is coming from the heart. They puncture at the hand, move the blood into the dialysis machine that cleans it from all the things that the kidney usually does, and then it brings it back to the vein, and it goes up to the heart and so on. But you don't want to do it on the real vein and the real artery at the time, because you have to eat about 3 times a week. So they want to develop artificial place connection between the artery and the vein, you know, where to put the needle. And there are 2 ways of doing it. So, this is called fistula. There is a red artery, and there is a vein. And what they try to do is to grow the vein a little longer so they can put the needles into the growth here. This takes about 6 weeks. It's the maturity of the vein. The second possibility is, rather than wait 6 weeks and go through this process, just to have a little plastic, elastic material, pipe, that goes from the artery into the vein, from inside the artery to inside the vein. And that's called the graft. Right now, the fistula is more popular, but as I said, it takes about 6 weeks to install it. And what we would like to know is how to overcome the problem of neo-intimal hyperplasia. Neo-intimal hyperplasia. Hyperplasia is growth, abnormal growth. Neo-intimal is, it comes in inside, and it's new, neo-intimal. So what happens is, in this fistula, in the vein, because of difference in pressure in the artery and the vein, and there tends to develop some mass inside the blood vessel, inside the Lumina. So inside here, or actually here, there are so because of the oxidative pressure, which is partly arises from the fluid dynamic, the shear forces, and so on, and partly because of antagonistic reaction of the cells that are not inside the vessel but on the outside of the vessel. So the blood vessel has three layers. One is called intima, very thin. The second is called media, and the third is called adventitia. And from the adventitia, growth factors are coming in and stimulate cells, muscle cells, and growth factors. And these guys are trying to push things, stuff into the vessel and trying to block it. And that's the growth, what you call the hyperplasia, and that starts to block the vessel. So within a year or so, the patient needs to come back for surgery and they have to replace the whole thing, which is not very nice. This also has a price tag of about $2 billion a year. So there's no, we don't here give any money value to the pain and trouble, just to the actual hospitalization and the surgery costs. So this is the problem that we are here trying to model the formation of neoplasia in the hemodialysis process. So this is a model here. It has the blood flow and the oxidative stress that are causing growth factors. Here there are three growth factors. They are causing increase in the smooth muscles, fibroblasts. So fibroblasts were very good stuff in wound healing. Here they are terrible. The same cells are doing something bad before they're doing something good. They are causing growth, but growth where we don't really want it. So they are the muscle cells, the fibroblasts secrete collagen. And both the smooth muscle cells, and the collagen move into the vessel and create the neo-intimate hyperplasia. Now, trying to model all of this, it's a little bit risky because we don't know numerically many of these coefficients. And it will just be, it's too open-ended. So we decided to do the following. We're going to look at all these growth factors as being average then, taken as one thing. Both all the cells, fibroblasts and smooth muscle, to be as one unit. And then describe the oxidative pressure and all of this as determined by the shrinking of the opening. The more it shrinks, the more stress there is. Yeah, and the collagen, all types of collagen are here, we are going to consider as one quantity. So I'm going to have three variables. Let's see. Yeah, so one is for all the chemical species, the second one, all the cellular species, and finally to the collagen and so on, the extracellular matrix. So the model is, here are three different calculations. Again, there are partial differential equations because we are talking about closing of the vessel. So we are talking about special variations. And this is, again, a graph. What does it show? This is a level at which the patient has to come for surgery. 50% of the volume has been filled with material. Our model shows, so most of the coefficients we can actually determine in this simple model, except one or so, and our model shows that within a little over 8 months, the opening of the vessel is going to reach the level where surgery will be called for. However, so this is if initially the chemicals, the growth factors, are at a certain concentration. But if we can somehow, with the drug, lower this level of chemicals from 1/5, from 25 here, then 5, so it's 1/5, then we can extend the life of the fistula by more than 2 months. So that's the result. And now, this is just, that's the first time that there's been a mathematical model of this process. And this is basically just a proof of concept. Because now comes about getting more data, getting the model more precise, and so on. So this paper was last week accepted to the journal, which is called Theoretical Biology and Medical Modeling. Next example is on tuberculosis, mycobacteria. There have been many models of tuberculosis, but what we are concentrating here, and this is our biologist here, John Hermel, is what is the difference between old and young? And I should add the word mice. The experiments are with mice. Young mice are 3 weeks old, the old mice are 12 months old. By the way, if you ever buy mice, remember that old mice are more expensive. It takes a long time to keep them in how does the body combat tuberculosis? It's basically the immune cells that are doing this are called the CD4 cells. They get the word that there is infection, they move in, and they secrete toxic material, which is called IFN gamma, interleukin interferon gamma. They go into the, what the bacteria does, it attacks the macrophages. No, HIV, what it does, attacks the macrophages. So they attack the macrophages, these are the policemen of the body. They attack the macrophages. So the CD4 cells, they move in and secrete this toxic stuff, IFN gamma. This goes into the macrophages and neutralize the bacterium, the bacteria. But the macrophage may be strong enough, or may already be almost in a hopeless situation. We differentiate between activated and infected. Infected are, they have a larger number of bacteria, and they are not able to sustain themselves. Eventually, they break down, and lots of bacteria are released into the space, into the lungs, and continue to infect other cells. So they are the CD4. Now, young mice, young people too, have a better system of CD4 cells. So they should do better when infected with bacteria. However, there is another type of cells that is involved. This is CD4-8. It's also fighting bacteria, also in the same way, but they are not as many as effective, except for one thing. Old ones have better CD8, and they immediately react. Young ones are still inexperienced. Their CD8 are not really, it takes them time, it takes 2 weeks before CD8 gets the alert, oops, there is tuberculosis, we have to do something. The old ones are more experienced. Within 1 week, they begin to secrete the IFA. So what we see is that the old mice do better than young mice for a few weeks. And after 22 days, it changes. So if you look at the bacterial load in mice, you will find that the bacterial load is larger for young mice for about 21 days, and then it changes. That's what I can model. So this is a diagram which explains the activated macrophages. Here is IFN gamma that the CD8 and the CD4 are sending to the macrophage. Now, how do these cells know what to do? They get the message from the macrophage, help, 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 help. Secretes IFN A in the looking 12. Well, and they know that it's time for them to do something, to send this poison. But there are several other things that I'm not going to get into this, but let me show you what the model is. So we are dealing here with macrophages that either are infected or activated or just resting there. They have not been subjected to the bacteria yet, to microbacteria. Then there are the bacteria that either reside in either the infected ones or the activated ones, or they're just around in the area, they have not yet penetrated anything. Then there are the cytokines. So these are the chemicals that make the signals for things to happen. The IFN gamma, the toxic one that I mentioned, the IL-12, and there is several others that we should really get into it because they are important for this. And there are the T cells, the 4 and the 8. Remember, the 8 are doing a better job for the old ones for a while. But eventually, the CD4 is really what counts. So if you look at all these variables, you get 11 PDEs, 40 parameters, 20 we can get from experiments, 20 we have to estimate. Very much like the form. This is actually typical in modeling biological processes, including neuroscience and so on. You know some parameters, you have to estimate others, and you hope that you get something which is fit with the experiment that you can try to use it for. So here is what the new simulation shows. This is the bacteria for the young, for the old ones. It's lower than for, see it's lower here, but the day 21, maybe it was 22, it changes. There are more bacteria for the old ones. And it stabilizes after 50 days in both cases. We have other, various other chemicals and these T cells. This is CD4, CD8, and again, these curves fit with experimental results. There are about 10 different graphs for these variables. They all fit with what is experimentally has either was known before or has been established by the biology that we have been working with and has not yet been published. Okay, the next one is I'll take 5 more minutes. The last one is glioma. This work, by the way, was just accepted last night in a journal called Experimental Gerontology. Now this work appeared in last year in a journal called Cancer Research, and the biologist Giulia Fulci, she finished her postdoc at Harvard Medical School, and Kiyoka moved meanwhile to Ohio State. In fact, he performed a brain surgery on a good friend of ours, yesterday. Just got email from my wife, surgery was okay. It was not cancer, it was a different kind of, it was, but glioma is a very difficult disease because there has not been any progress in the last 30 years. Life expectancy is about a year. So the question is, what can we do about it? So let me just make the following remark. Here you have a cell. A virus is not a living thing, according to the definition that I gave at the beginning, because it cannot reproduce itself. But it can reproduce, it cannot reproduce itself inherently, but it can reproduce using the machinery of a cell. So when it invades a cell, uses the DNA of a cell, it can replicate itself. So that's a way to, and then after the cell lyses, a swarm of virus, it replicates very fast, comes out, and the number of replications, I'll call it the burst size. So you can replicate virus by injecting them into cells. They will use the cell mechanism, and the cell will die. Probably the death will be accelerated by the fact that there are virus inside, and then lots of virus will come out. So the idea is to use this mechanism to fight cancer cells, to infect them and kill them. So such a virus that is used to kill tumor cells is called oncolytic virus. Now, it's not enough that the virus kills cancer cells. It also has to learn not to kill healthy cells. Otherwise, it will destroy the whole you know. So oncolytic virus is usually referred to a virus which only infects tumor cells, reproducing them, and we would like it to be replication competent, so it will not just reproduce, when the cell dies, just two virus will come, or three virus. We'd like to see hundreds of them coming out, and it should not harm healthy cells. So these are constraints, and such virus can be made in the lab. For example, the Dr. Kiyoka that I mentioned before, an oncologist, brain oncologist, he has herpes virus that he modified to make it a colitic virus. So in viral therapy, the important things are that safety and efficacy. Efficacy means replication competent, and safety does not harm healthy cells. And now, viral therapy is not a new concept. It has been used in other types of cancer, and it is also at clinical stage. That is, it passed the mouse stage, and it's used for already testing on people. It has not yet reached the market, which is post-third phase, but it is a second phase of clinical trials. Okay, there is a problem with this therapy, and this is that the immune system, which was very good for fighting tuberculosis, is very bad now. So the immune cells notice that virus is in the tumor cells. They cannot tell the difference between tumor cells and not tumor cells. They saw there is virus in the cell, kill that cell, engulf that cells. So all these killers, soldiers in the immune army, all the phagocytes and killer cells and so on, macrophages, they go jump and engulf the cancer cell, and don't let the virus do anything. So they defeat the purpose of this therapy by inadvertently, and that's bad. So how do you do? What do you do against it? You try to block the immune system, suppress it, and oops, you do it with cyclophosphamide, which is very very toxic chemotherapy, and okay, so we have here and what happens is, so the immune cells, because there's macrophages come in, they multiply fast, try to kill the infected cancer cells, and then when the number decreases a lot of the cancer cells, then the immune cells see that they're not needed anymore, so they commit suicide. Or they kill their friends. You know, they shoot against each other. They send some chemical against each other. So that means that they are diminished in a quadratic form. Not linearly, but quadratically. And the quadratic years. Now here's an experimental thing that from Giulia Fulci. So what we see here is a no cyclophosphamide, no CPA, no herpes simplex virus, no virus. There is the situation with the cancer cells after 6 hours, there is our 72 hours, and she counted the number of cells here. And we got these numbers. Then, still no cyclophosphamide, but 3 hours after injecting the virus, and we see here where the chunks of this are being destroyed, the virus are being killed. Here. They are still over here. She counted the number of virus here. After 72 hours, they are coming back to life. I mean, not to us, I mean, these are the tumor cells. They're coming back to life. If you use the cyclophosphamide, you suppress the immune system, then you get better results. Because now, if you look at the number of tumor cells, it's smaller than here. And after 72 hours, it's still quite small. So the CPA in here. So we have all these numbers, and in building up the getting out the coefficients of the system, we are using these numbers. This is, by the way, from the simulation, this is the result that we get. So, what we see here is a number of cancer cells after 6 hours, after 72 hours, with cyclophosphamide, without cyclophosphamide, and all these things show a very good fit. You have to think also the experiments are not 100% precise. So we were happy with this. This is the system of equation that describe the uninfected cells, infected cells, the dead cells, the necrotic cells, the immune cells, the macrophages, the virus particles, and then we get the radius of the tumor. And then what we see is interesting. Let me go into this picture here. Replication number is very, very important. Right now, what they have been able to produce is a replication number of 50. The radius of the tumor of glioma is going to grow. But if you can get it to 150, it's going to go, this 150 is going to go down. Even without CPA, it's going to go down. So, and they can increase the number, even to 1,000, but they are not, they are going to attack healthy cells too. Remember, you have to make it so it will not attack healthy cells. And this is what start with 50 at least by the time this paper appeared. Now, there are other things that we can get from the model that are very interesting, and you see it in the experiments. So I'll just mention one. When the aggregation number is large, so then the infection goes up a lot. The uninfected goes down. When there's lots of infection, the immune goes up. Lots of macrophages. They kill the infected cells, and then they kill themselves, and the immune goes down. It went down, but not all the virus, not all the cancer cells die. Then the uninfected, then, not all the cancer cells were infected. There were some that were uninfected by virus. This number now goes up. It goes up, the virus begins to renew its attack. It has evidence to which to enter. And then the infected ones are going up too when they see the virus. So we get this kind of oscillation, and you can see this in the various quantities that we describe here, depending on the replication number and so on. So this oscillation seems natural with what we see in the experiments. The conclusion is not good that the oncolytic virus, herpes simplex R3, as it's called, cannot be related to your mind. If the replication number increases to 150, the radius will go down, but still, even with a small radius, there still will be particles, cancer cells, that are uninfected. What the chemotherapy can do is only decrease the number, but not destroy them completely. We tried various procedures of cyclophosphamide, but it doesn't really make that much difference. And I believe that this is the last of us. So with this, I thank you very much for.